Now, you may recall a video I made and a blog post I covered a few months ago about Hypercursor, an SVG cursor format coming out of the Hyperland project. Now, there were discussions early on about using this format inside of Plasma. The discussions seemed like they were going fairly well. There were changes made to the format to better support the format inside of KDE, but ultimately they decided that this isn't what they want to do, and they want to do their own thing. Now, the format they have is very much based on Hypercursor, and in many ways is basically the same thing, but as with any sort of new standard, there is going to be these splits about very random little things. This is just what happens. I would have preferred to have a single format from the very start, but I don't think there's been anything like this before, especially not in the FOSS world. Now, obviously we have working cursors and working cursor themes. It is visible on the screen right now. I'm a KDE Plasma user. This has the Breeze cursor as the default, but I'm using the Edwita cursor because this is just what I prefer. It's more similar to what I'm used to. And I'm sure that all of you, if you actually care about your cursor theme, also have a favorite cursor theme as well. So what exactly is the problem then? Well, the traditional X-Cursor format basically sucks. Now, it has a lot of problems, but not all of the problems with X-Cursor are inherently problems with X-Cursor, it's problems with how it's being used. Now, at its very core, an X-Cursor theme is basically just a collection of images and then some metadata about what those images mean. The theme name, whether it's extending another theme, things like this. As an example, here we have the Edwita cursor theme. So in here we have a bunch of directories, but the main ones that we care about here are the cursors directory. This includes all of the individual cursors, and then the index.theme file. This is where the metadata lives. These other folders do have meaning, but these are additional things. Now, all of your system cursor themes, these are going to exist in /user/share/icons. If you install it from a package manager, this is where it is going to go. Do keep in mind that not everything in here is going to be a cursor theme though, because this is the general icons directory, folder icons, application icons, things like that. Any sort of icon theme is also going to be here, with the local user location being home/.local/share/icons. I've personally never installed anything here, but if you want to have it dedicated to your specific user, that's where it goes. Now, the cursors directory contains a list of X-cursor files and symbolic links to represent cursor shape aliases, e.g. the arrow being an alias for default. Now, these files aren't just, you know, PNG files like you're typically used to working with. Each of these files represent a number of different cursor sizes, and they are stored as their own specific format for X-cursor files. In the case of Edwita, we have the following sizes: 24, 32, 48, 64, and 96 pixels. These are pretty standard sizes to do with an X-cursor theme. These are not required, and other sizes can be done. In fact, you could go theoretically as big as you wanted. There's not a limitation in the format, but there are other limitations we'll get into a bit later. And here's another very important thing. Whilst it is called X-Cursors, and it was initially made in the context of X11, it's not just about cursors for X. It is also being used under Wayland. But it is being handled a little bit differently, and this is what I mean about some of the problems not necessarily being a problem with the format itself. X11 assumes that the cursor size is specified in device pixels, while Wayland assumes that it's in the logical pixels. Logical pixels have the same visual size across various devices, while physical pixels, well, device pixels, are specific to a particular device. For example, 24 logical pixels on an output with a scale factor of 2 corresponds to 48 physical pixels. Cursor sizes in X-cursor files are specified in the device pixels, so you can have what looks like the exact same settings, but the cursor is being rendered at a different size. Now, this wouldn't be a problem if all of the applications we had were Wayland applications or X11 applications. The problem is we have things that are in X-Wayland, so they're X11 running under Wayland. So when you go into the X-Wayland window, you might have a different cursor size, and it doesn't make any sense. And cursor sizes in X-cursor files are specified in the device pixels. Why this matters is this part here. Another very important detail is the X-cursor size environment variable is treated differently by X11 and Wayland native applications. For example, if X-cursor size is set to 24 and the output scale is set to 2, an X11 application would load a cursor with the size 24, but a Wayland application would effectively load a cursor with the size 48, 24 times by 2, because it would see that the output is scaled, so the provided cursor needs to be scaled accordingly as well. So even though it looks like you should be running the same settings, you end up with different sized cursors. The reason why this matters is we don't just run X11 or just run Wayland applications. We have this thing called X-Wayland. So you need to account for the fact that X-Wayland is going to think the cursor is a different size. Right here is an example of that not being accounted for. Now, obviously, it's not a major deal, right? Like, you can work with it. The cursor is going to work the same way. But it does feel a little bit jarring when you go from one window to another and things just randomly change size. The most painful thing about X-Cursor is its lack of proper high DPI support. If you need to load a cursor that is size 24 with a scale factor of 2, so effectively a size 48 cursor, this is fine if the cursor theme provides a cursor with such a size. But what if it doesn't? What if it's a scale factor of 3 and you need a size 72 cursor and the cursor theme doesn't have it? At the moment, every compositor and client applies its own policies. Some find the cursor with the closest size and use that. Some find the cursor with the closest size and then scale it to match the requested size at the cost of adding some blurriness, and so on. It's a mess because neither compositors nor clients can agree how to handle such a case. You could easily observe the cursor changing its size when moving between windows owned by different applications or when moving the cursor between the window and its decoration. Here we have an example of exactly that happening. So the decoration and the application are scaling things in a slightly different way. Luckily, this can be worked around using the cursor shape protocol. This is the protocol that is backing Hypercursor. This is the protocol that is backing the current thing that is being done here. This is basically the solution to all the problems we have. Except the fact that GNOME isn't really a big fan of it, so it's fairly unlikely that it's going to be adopted in GTK anytime soon. This allows the application to delegate the compositor the task of loading and displaying cursors. So instead of every application trying to handle it itself, the compositor does everything. The compositor is the single source of truth. The bottom line is the X-cursor format is unsuitable for high DPI model that we presently have on Wayland and is never going to go away because screens are not going to become any less high resolution and any less high DPI. Now, you might reasonably say, okay, if there is this scaling issue, just include more cursor sizes. So if you want it to be size 95 or size 97, there's just a size already there for it. And this is a reasonable suggestion with a reasonable image format. That is not what X-Cursor is. Another issue with the X-Cursor format is the image data is stored in an uncompressed format. It is okay if you need to provide cursors with small sizes, for example, 72. But there are cases when you need to display a cursor at a very large size. For example, one such case is the shake cursor accessibility feature in the Plasma Wayland session, which, from my testing, does not have a size limit. So you could theoretically have a cursor at the size of your screen. Even just supporting up to 250 pixels, this can lead to packages ballooning upwards of 100 megabytes for a cursor theme. not a crazy animated cursor theme, just a regular old cursor theme. If you want to make it clear when going the size of your screen, you're going to start seeing multiple gigabytes for a cursor theme. Now, modern devices have a lot of storage. You can store that, but do you really want to waste multiple gigabytes on a cursor theme? Because I don't. Now, in Plasma 6.1, they did include a workaround to avoid the blurry cursor. So this is without the workaround. Let's skip ahead to right here. It gets blurry. We've all seen this before. If you were using Plasma 6 around launch, you definitely saw this. This is it with the workaround. Skip to here. As you can see, it is considerably clearer. It is not perfectly clear. I'm not sure if that is the video compression or what it is, but regardless, it is much, much clearer with the Breeze cursor theme because they just included some high resolution images specifically for that theme. But as we've established, I like the Edweda theme. It is much more similar to what you have on Windows and macOS. I don't think the Breeze theme is bad. It's just not my jam. The X-Cursor format was perfectly suitable for the use cases that existed in the late 90s and early 2000s. If you had a 1024 by 768 display, and that was a high-end display, a size 96 cursor is a massive cursor. Most people were never going to be running that. 24 would have been perfectly fine. Also, Wayland wasn't a thing yet, and when it was a thing, it wasn't a thing most people were using. So you didn't have this mismatch of X11 and Wayland applications. Everything just worked consistently. Nowadays, in 2024, we've got fractional scaling. We have really high resolution displays as well. Like, it is not uncommon for someone to have a 4K display. And on 4K, a size 96 cursor is sort of like the bare minimum to have a usable cursor. Most people would prefer something a little bit bigger. We've got accent colors. We've got features that enlarge the cursor, the screen shake feature, and so on. Alongside the cursor shape protocol, which has already been merged and is already in use in places like Hyperland, this requires a scalable vector graphics format for your cursor, SVG being the most common. Now, there is a good reason to do SVG. I know some people don't like SVG and there are other formats people can use, but a lot of people making cursors, they make their cursors first in SVG and then render it out into the formats used for different cursor themes, so most people already have the SVG cursor anyway. It's just a matter of building a theme format around it. So, first of all, let's build a list of requirements that the SVG cursor format must satisfy. Support SVG files, otherwise it wouldn't be an SVG format. Doesn't need to be on the list, but sure, whatever. Easy porting process for existing clients and compositors. So it shouldn't be this crazy complex format that nobody really cares to want to understand. It should be easy to work with. It should be easy to develop and analyze SVG cursor themes. Xcursor is a binary file format which requires a special tool to create Xcursor files. We would like to avoid that with SVG cursors. Last and the most important requirement is there must be some compatibility with the existing cursor theme format. We must not be required to write a new system settings module to handle the new cursor format, and the apps that don't support SVG cursors should easily fall back to the Xcursor format. So you don't want a situation where you have these nicely rendered pretty cursors, and then if you go to an application that doesn't support it, it just uses a whole different cursor theme. So this is how the theme would look. This might look more complex, but it's basically the same thing. Here we have the index.theme like we had before. We have the cursors directory. This includes all of the old legacy cursors, and then another directory, cursors scalable. This has the SVGs alongside JSON metadata files. Index.theme has the same format for both Xcursor and SVG cursors, because if it works, why bother changing it? It makes it a lot easier to port things over. In cursor scalable, every cursor shape must have its own directory, or if it's an alias, then it must be a symlink. Every cursor shape directory must contain the cursor image in a metadata.json file providing the information about the current cursor. So in this case, we have left pointer pointing to default, and we have await, this being a directory containing the metadata and then the SVG. Now the default cursor here being a regular static cursor, but the weight cursor, this being an animated SVG. For a static cursor, this is what the metadata looks like. It is very simple, and look, I know some people don't like JSON. I personally am a fan of the format. The file name property specifies the file name of the SVG file. The hotspot X and hotspot Y properties specify the coordinates of the hotspot. The hotspot in the cursor determines the point where interaction with other elements on the screen occurs. So if you want it to, for whatever reason, be the bottom right-hand corner of the cursor, you could specify that. Please don't do that. Please. Please. The nominal size property specifies the cursor size that the SVG file represents. The nominal size is used to decide how much the SVG image and the hotspot coordinates need to be scaled in order to get a cursor with the requested size. Now for an animated cursor, two things change. Now we have a list of these different properties and also an additional property, the delay property. This indicates the animation delay to the next frame. Now, it is worth mentioning that SVG supports animations natively. However, that approach was not chosen for cursor animations for two reasons. To allow caching SVG render results more easily, and two, require fewer changes in the compositors and the apps to adapt the SVG cursor format. This animation system is sort of supposed to replicate the way it works with the X cursor system, so it's kind of similar enough where the adaptation isn't crazy difficult. Also, as mentioned with this directory right here, not every application is going to support SVG cursors, so you need to make sure you have a fallback with the X cursor theme there as well. So basically, these themes are a collection of both X cursor and the new SVG format. Now, whilst not currently supported, one thing that could be neat in the future is accent color support. Since the color content is specified using the SVG format, it should be possible to recolor the cursor based on the currently configured accent color. As of now, it is not implemented, but in general, this is doable, and perhaps such a feature will be added to Plasma someday. Recoloring is very common with folder and application icons. I would never go ahead and use this just to make my cursor, you know, match my current accent color. I think that is stupid. What I do think is useful is it in an accessibility context. So, let's say you have your cursor and you want it to be fluorescent pink so it is always very easy to see. That, I do think, is cool. Or maybe have the cursor cycle between various different colors so it's easy to find if you lose it. Currently, this cursor format is not officially standardized, but they are looking forward to making it so. Right now, as I've said, there are two formats for doing SVG cursors. There is the hypercursor format, there is the KDE format. Now, the Hyperland developer will argue that the format being used for this is literally the exact same thing, but with JSON. Not exactly true. Making use of the same index theme and using standard approaches for storing the data does make it different enough in my books. And I'm not sure how this is going to ultimately go down. Obviously, being around for longer, the hypercursor format has a lot more support, but ultimately they're both fairly simple formats, and making a converter to go between them, making a converter to actually generate these themes in the first place, wouldn't be that difficult. So I'm curious to see how all of this goes long into the future. But what do you think? Do you think this is a thing that even matters in the first place? Do you think there is an issue with cursors? Do you like SVGs? I would like to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, LiberaPay linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and tell me your favorite cursor theme. I would like to know. That would be cool. What is this?